Recorded Books presents Assassin's Creed, The Resurrection Plot, by Kate Heartfield, narrated by Moira Quirk. Chapter 1. Pierrette Arnaud sat on the edge of a four-story roof and pulled her cloak tightly around her, so the blue ball gown beneath wouldn't draw attention. Beside her, Safia El-Nadi was dressed in her usual dark shawl that fell in a peak over the forehead, a thin gold cylinder between her eyes, holding the black crocheted veil that hit at her waist. Much less conspicuous, at least in this part of Cairo. The women were two small additions to a skyscape of square roofs and twisting domes, lattice windows and fluted columns, stonework and plaster. Their feet dangled from the roof of a gable, a good vantage point. Safia had kept company with Pierrette on the walk from the house they shared near one of the old city gates. From the beginning, Pierrette felt they were being followed. She trusted her instincts, but if there was someone following, she couldn't see them. Perhaps she had reached the moment in her life as an assassin when ghosts would dog her steps. It would only be fair. She had created enough of them. Nonetheless, she had signalled to Safia to change course, so they'd come to the street where Safia's husband, Gamal Sabri, was selling books today. It was a street they knew well, and they'd both climbed lightly up onto the roofs in a narrow alley. In the coffee shop opposite their rooftop, a half dozen men smoked long pipes under an awning and chatted with Gamal, who had spread the books from his cart onto a carpeted table. Gamal liked to say that bookselling was merely an excellent way for an assassin to monitor the streets of Cairo, but he couldn't hide his passion for the job. Gamal caught the women's eyes, his turban tilting slightly as he looked up. The street was busy, with water carriers and vendors calling out, and women passing through on donkeys, servants at their side. Gamal took an English copy of Darwin's On the Origin of Species off his table to show it to a customer. Pierrette recognised it from the golden triangles on the green spine. She'd perused the books on Gamal's cart many times.
"I see no followers," Safia said.
The shadows were long. The sun was beginning to set. She had to be at the opera house soon. Still, something kept her where she was.
"Do you want to go over the plan again?" Safia asked patiently. "You seem nervous."
Pierrette was 37 years old, a skilled assassin and a veteran circus performer. She did not think of herself as a person who got nervous. The reason she'd come to Egypt in the first place was that she'd been frustrated by the unwillingness of the British assassins to take risks. She was here to fight. She was grateful to have a task she believed in. Nonetheless, she couldn't deny her unease. Safia seemed to sense it too. She had spoken in French, although she usually spoke in Arabic to help Pierrette practice.
"I suppose I am. It's been a long time since I've been in fine company," Pierrette said, tucking a silk bow beneath her cloak.
Truth be told, she was looking forward to the chance to wear a beautiful new dress.
"And I've never met the Khedive."
She was looking forward to that, too.
Khedive Ismail Pasha, Viceroy of Egypt, technically answered to the Ottoman Sultan, but he had ambitions of his own. Not only was he intent on rebuilding half of Cairo, but he had covered Egypt in railway lines and presided over the 10-year construction of the Suez Canal. Tonight, weeks of celebrations would begin as the canal was nearly ready to open. The Khedive would entertain his guests, including heads of state at a reception and opera, and Pierrette would be among them.
"He will be dazzled by you," Safia said staunchly. "Who wouldn't be? Besides, he wants your expertise for his new circus and hippodrome."
"That's just the line we used to get my invitation. The Khedive has many people to advise him on entertainments."
I wouldn't be so sure. He had to send away his Armenian impresario in the spring, don't forget.
I haven't forgotten, and I still don't think that story makes sense. Why did the man leave Cairo freely, with money in his pocket, if he tried to plant a bomb in the Khedive theater box? It doesn't add up. There is too much happening in this city that we don't understand.
It was not for lack of trying, she knew. Cairo's assassins kept careful watch on their ancient enemies, the Templars. There was always a strong Templar presence in the city, since that order was obsessed with finding artifacts, so it had a spy on every archaeological dig site. After the bomb was found in the theatre, the assassins' minds had gone right away to the Templar-orchestrated assassination of Abraham Lincoln 4 years ago, but there was no evidence connecting the Templars to the attempt on the Khedive's life. All monarchs had to deal with such threats, after all.
The Khedive has guards to protect him. Your job tonight is to face a much more terrible danger, Safia said.
She leaned toward Pierrette and said with mock horror,
An American businessman.
That got a smile from Pierrette. She wiped her hands and prepared to leave their perch when a flash of purple and gold caught her eye. On the table across the street, Gamal had placed a book upright so that its gorgeous embossed cover faced them. The Bulak Press edition of The Book of Gnosis by Ibrahim Haki Erzurumi. It was a striking and unusual edition, which was why it was their agreed symbol. It meant danger. Safia had noticed it too. Moving as little as possible, they swept their gazes over the streets below. Nothing unusual in the street between them and the coffee shop. Gamal was casually chatting, but there was no doubt his signal was deliberate. Over to the left, in the alley between buildings, stood a man in European dress. He was doing a good impression of waiting for someone, but what he was actually doing was listening. Listening to Pierrette and Safia. Pierrette's eyes narrowed. Safia pointed toward the man, a signal that this one was hers, and rose silently to her feet. She leaped over the edge of the roof, her cloak floating for a moment. There was a sound like a sack falling off a wagon, then a sound like a wagon wheel in need of grease. While Safia dealt with the spy, Pierrette checked their surroundings. She glanced at the coffee shop opposite and grinned. No one had noticed anything because Gamal's well-trained donkey was conveniently braying, and customers and tradesmen alike all offered help to the apparently frustrated and apologetic bookseller. Pierrette ran to each corner of the roof, searching for accomplices. The streets and alleys seemed clear of anyone suspicious. She and Safia and Gamal knew the names and faces of every water carrier, beggar, food vendor, itinerant priest, scholar, or listless lover in the neighbourhood. There was no one else out of place. Taking her time so as not to rip the beautiful dress, which really had cost quite a lot, Pierrette climbed down into the alley where Safia whispered her final words over the man she'd just killed. It didn't seem likely he'd hear them. He'd died from a single blow from above, Safia's knife in the back of his neck between his vertebrae. Safia straightened up.
A Templar, lackey. I've seen his face before. May he find mercy.
If the Templars were following her, they must have got wind of the fact that Pierrette had an invitation to the opera tonight. How much did they know about her plans? All the same, she felt strangely light now that her instincts had been confirmed. Let them come. If they wanted a battle, they would find her willing.
Chapter 2 Safia and Pierrette dragged the spy's body into a recessed doorway. Night was falling, and once it was fully dark, Gamal and Safia would use the book cart to take the body to the necropolis, where, by tradition, both Templars and assassins left their dead to be claimed.
Safia motioned Pierrette on and stayed to keep watch in the meantime. Pierrette left Old Cairo, walking toward the setting sun. Calls to prayer rang out as she reached the new neighborhoods, where the streets were wide and the buildings low. Behind her, lanterns carried by people as they walked or rode gave the impression of fireflies from a distance. Ahead of her, a line of gas lamps lit the new district of Azbakea below the purple sky. Pierrette knew this area well because Gamal often came here, as did other booksellers. He would spread his books out on the wall that surrounded the Azbakea garden. In the daytime, the garden was filled with children feeding the ducks and families in little boats on the ponds. On this night, it was busy with people on their way to the new opera house, a short walk from the hotels clustered around the garden. The Khedive had invited heads of state to witness the upcoming opening of the Suez Canal to traffic. A feat of engineering 10 years in the making, the canal would allow ships to pass directly from the Mediterranean Sea to the Red Sea instead of going around Africa. Pierrette had always believed that human efforts could reshape the world, and it was exciting to be here at this moment when humans were dividing the continents of Africa and Asia. Some of the illustrious visitors would not arrive in Egypt for another week or two, but tonight's guest of honour would be Empress Eugenie of France. Pierrette's job was to make sure that one particular guest at the opera never got a chance to speak with the Empress. Albert Hawkins. Amira Benyamina, a master assassin and a member of Cairo's council, ran a radical newspaper which helped her find information and plant sources. Yesterday, she'd intercepted a telegram that suggested a Templar called Albert Hawkins was going to take advantage of the Empress's presence at the opera to conduct some business with her. Amira used to live in Paris, and her connections there had told her that the Templars had been trying to influence Eugenie for years, hoping to use her to sway French policy. The Cairo Council had decided the moment had come to take out Albert Hawkins before he could do any more damage. Killing a Templar was always a considered decision. It risked bringing attention from the police and retribution from the order. But Hawkins had to die. Since he'd come to Egypt a few years ago, Hawkins had been trying to undermine the Khedive's efforts to chart Egypt's own course. The Khedive seemed genuinely interested in establishing greater freedom for all, whatever the Ottoman bureaucrats said about it. He had put an end to forced labour, despite French insistence that it was necessary to finish work on the Suez Canal. Albert Hawkins had made it hard for the Khedive to stand on principle. It was an open secret that Hawkins had built an unfinished railway to an uninhabited area near the new canal, using unauthorized forced labor to do it. A project designed to take speculators' money and make the Khedive look like he had no control in Egypt. There was no doubt about it. Albert Hawkins was a blight on the world. The assassins were trying to make Egypt a bulwark against corruption and coercion, and Hawkins stood in the way of that by undermining the Khedive and his goals. With him dead, the Khedive would have more breathing room, and the Templars in Egypt would have one less connection to their American and European interests. Pierrette didn't know what conversation Hawkins hoped to have with Empress Eugenie tonight, but it would not be good for the people of Egypt or the people of France. Pierrette had seen no signs of another Templar follower since she parted from Safia, and no longer felt uneasy. When no one was looking, she pulled off her old cloak and stowed it behind a loose rock in the garden wall, one of the Cairo assassins' many drop spots. Her old cloak had been suitable when she was trying not to attract attention in the streets, but going into the opera, it would have the opposite effect. Pierrette walked differently in her blue dress. The style gave her a pleasing ease of movement. It was sleeveless, save for the golden epaulettes. She tugged her white gloves up over her elbow, adjusting the gold cuff that disguised the spring device for her hidden blade. The new opera square was filled with people, milling past the great equestrian statue, past the palm trees in perfect symmetry, to the opera house. Beyond the illuminated opera house, the city rose on its hills, a shadow against the night. She slipped in among the richly dressed people coming out of the Aspasia garden, a slow tide through the columns on either side of the opera house doors. People of every description, young and old, every shade of skin, conversations in several languages and accents. The only commonality was that they all had an invitation to the opera and money to dress for it. Most guests went into the large room where there was food and drink before the performance. Pierrette kept climbing to the third floor. Albert Hawkins would be at the Khedive's private reception, waiting for a chance to greet the Empress, who was expected to make a late entrance. Hawkins' plan would be to speak with her at the entr'acte, but he would be dead by then. At a door flanked by two guards, she gave her name. They admitted her to a long room, warm with light from great crystal chandeliers over tables filled with food and flowers. About 20 people stood in a few clusters. To the right, a doorway led to the box seats in the auditorium. She'd studied the building plans. Opposite that, dark windows overlooked the rooftop terrace. There was red bunting around the walls and a large photograph of the Sultan at one end of the room. At the other end, the actual ruler of Egypt, the Khedive, in the flesh. There was no mistaking him, a stocky man with thick eyebrows wearing a dark suit with a red fez. There were three security officers near him. Good. One of the half-dozen people talking to the Khedive was just as familiar to Pierrette from the photographs she'd studied. Albert Hawkins was in his 30s, with dark curls tamed with pomade above a boyish face. He didn't look like a robber baron. He looked as though he had dressed up as a rich man for a costume party. His suit fit poorly, and he was holding an ornate silver cane. Affectation, certainly, but also, likely, a weapon. Appearances could be deceiving. And so could Albert Hawkins. By that innocent half-smile as he listened to the conversation, you'd never know he had left a trail of cheated investors across the American West, and at least three wives with children. He'd come to Egypt a few years ago and established himself as a man with useful expertise. He knew about cotton production, the source of Egypt's wealth in the Khedive's early years, when the American Civil War had made Egypt the world's top supplier. He claimed military and logistics expertise from his service in the Confederate Army, which was how he convinced the Khedive to let him build his railway from Alexandria to an uninhabited spot midway down the canal in the first place. After all, soon the canal would be lined with new settlements, he argued. He'd been just as persuasive with the local people, convincing them they'd be sorry if they refused to work for him. When the Khedive told him to stop, Hawkins had protested that he had no other way of completing the line. He demanded an exorbitant payment from the Khedive, whose coffers were depleting now that the United States was back in the cotton trade, all the right to carry on forcing people to work for him. Unsurprisingly, this was the subject of conversation as Pierrette joined the group of people talking with the Khedive. Every assassin had their own way of hiding in plain sight, and this was Pierrette's. She'd long been comfortable moving between classes and worlds, from circus sawdust to upper-class mahogany. She was a performer and could play the role expected. In some rooms, her reputation as a retired circus performer, traveller and equestrienne would not have given her much cachet, but here it did. State-of-the-art cultural entertainment was as much a part of building the new Egypt as the canal was. An older French woman was saying to the Khedive,
"But I thought Egypt had an ancient tradition of requiring public labour for public works. Don't you call it the corvée?
The Khedive replied in perfect French.
I beg your pardon, madame, but you call it the corvée. It is a French word, and no wonder, since it existed there until recently as well. We have abolished it in Egypt, and your emperor made sure it cost us dearly to do so.
Our emperor?
The French woman looked aghast.
He demanded that we pay 38 million francs to the Suez Canal Company to compensate them for the lack of forced labor. But you see, we are building a country here, madame, not merely a canal.
And now you invite the French Empress to see your canal open, said Hawkins, in American-accented French. To see your victory? The Khedive cocked his head.
I invite a good friend to witness a historic day, and to see Rigoletto performed, of course. I had hoped to have commissioned a new opera from Signor Verdi, but it is not ready yet. Artists cannot be rushed.
Much like canals, said Hawkins. He was quick, even in his halting French. While everyone smiled at Hawkins's joke, he scanned their faces. His gaze landed on Pierrette, and the Khedive saw and turned to look at her.
I present Mademoiselle Pierrette Arnaud, said the aide standing beside him.
The Khedive took her hand and smiled.
Ah, the equestrian. I hope you will consider coming to talk to me about circuses. I would be grateful for your advice about my new hippodrome.
Safia had been right. The Khedive did seem interested in her expertise, but perhaps he was just polite.
I have not performed for years, she said, a little wistfully.
Her work as an assassin was crucial. She did believe that serving the light required some people to work in the dark, but sometimes she missed the days when all that mattered was the beauty she created, when she could show off her skills, when she could bring light to the eyes of every person in a crowd.
But you once performed all over Europe, the Khedive replied.
Clearly, he'd done his research.
Do you find that tastes vary by city?
Every city is different, but the best hippodromes do not worry about tastes or fashions. All these modern troops with their performing cockatoos and goats and elephants, they don't treat the animals well, and it's a sad and smelly affair. Real horse people, though, treat their horses better than humans, and they'll work marvels if given the chance to improve their craft instead of trying to find work all the time. If I were managing a hippodrome, Your Highness, I would pay the best equestrian performers and keep them there year-round. Soon you'll have an attraction that will draw people to the city instead of a mere copy of what every other city has.
He contemplated her.
If you were managing a hippodrome, you say?
She felt herself blush. How could she make it clear she was not looking for a job? She glanced aside as she thought and realized that Hawkins had left the group. He was, in fact, gone from the room entirely. This was her moment. If time had permitted, the council might have developed a plan to kill Hawkins in a quieter location, a suborned cab driver, a dark alley. But they'd only intercepted the telegram yesterday. Besides, as Pierrette had argued, it might be easier to catch him off guard at a public event. He was known for going out on terraces and balconies to smoke and conduct business. The assassins had sent Hawkins a telegram purporting to be from a dealer of enslaved Sudanese people, asking to meet on the terrace before the Empress arrived. The plan was in motion. She made a quick excuse about the heat and, brushing aside the Khedive's concern, strode out through the terrace doors. It was empty. Cursing herself for becoming distracted and missing which way the man had gone, she went back through the reception room, moving swiftly through the crowd. She flung open a door, then another. Then she nearly gasped at the sight of the auditorium.
Four levels of boxes formed a horseshoe, of which she was in the middle, three levels up. Below, there were chairs on the floor level and a great stage with a curtain bearing the portraits of the Khedive and of his guest of honour, Empress Eugenie. The auditorium was empty. No. There was a figure in the box nearest the stage and one level down. By the richness of the chairs and flanking curtain, the royal box. He leaned forward slightly into the light, and she glimpsed Albert Hawkins's curls. Pierrette stepped back into the shadows. What was he doing in the Khedive's seat? She remembered the bomb in the theatre in the spring. If it was a bomb being planted now, where would Hawkins have obtained it? The guards would have searched the building. No, there must be some other reason. Hawkins was an arrogant, narcissistic risk-taker. He probably wanted to see what it felt like to sit in the royal box. Maybe it had tickled him to plan an assignation there. The slaver and the empress might not be the only people he planned to talk to tonight. Her unease from earlier in the day had returned, but she had him now in an empty auditorium, too far for the throwing knife in her boot, and she couldn't risk missing by an inch and giving him a chance to make a noise. Back out into the curving corridor that connected the entrances to all the boxes, she ran lightly to where it ended, before the royal boxes, which must have had their own entrance. She moved into the last box, planning to drop from there to the second level, right next to the royal box. Instead, she saw Hawkins climbing up towards the third level, hanging from the railing over the royal box a few feet to her right and a little below her. Pierrette winced and stepped backwards into the shadow, so she could just see part of his jacket tails moving as he climbed. The box above the royal one was covered top to bottom in a tight lattice that screened it from view. It was for the Khedive's wives who lived in seclusion. Hawkins clung to the lattice screen and seemed to have found a way to open it at the end closest to the stage. She leaned forward just enough to see him swing the screen fully open and slip inside and out of view. Why would Hawkins want to go into the wives' box? It didn't make any sense. She went to the edge of her box, climbed over and dropped, hanging by her fingernails from the railing, inching her way below him as he retied the screen in position. She was tempted to thrust her blade upward right then, but blood drops in the orchestra pit would raise questions. After listening for his breath, she moved. Left hand up to the lattice, pull. Right hand on the lattice, pull. It creaked, and a small part of her brain wondered whether it would hold her weight. But she didn't need it to hold for long. She was looking into his startled eyes when she released her hidden blade and thrust it through a hole in the lattice, right into his windpipe. There was no one in the auditorium to hear those horrible, soft sounds. He grabbed at her fingers weakly, then collapsed in a heap. Damn! She'd been hoping he'd fall backwards for blood clean-up purposes. She pulled herself over to the edge of the screen, unfastened it, and slipped into the box. The blood, luckily, was mostly confined to his white waistcoat. As the light left his eyes, Pierrette put one hand on his shoulder. It was her job now to ease the passing of even this odious man. A necessary passing, sanctioned and commissioned by a council, not a murder out of passion or self-interest. Unlike her teacher, Simeon, she did not agonize about the philosophy, and she had never been religious. But she felt that a human, at the end, should not pass alone, even if their only company was their killer. She pulled a white handkerchief out of her reticule, on which she had embroidered her own initials, P.A., intertwined with those of her target, A.H., in simple stitches, the work of an hour this morning. She let the handkerchief rest briefly on his bloody throat, and then tucked it back where it came from, a sign she'd carried out her assignment. Not that it had gone to plan.
She had a conveniently situated wagon beneath the rooftop terrace from which she'd planned to toss the body of Albert Hawkins. Here, she only had a blood-covered corpse and nowhere to carry it, and an audience outside, eager for the opera to begin. The box was framed with heavy red curtains pulled to the side. They seemed entirely decorative. There was no reason for anyone to pull them, especially given that the wives' box was already obscured from view. From here, they'd be able to hear the opera and to see basic movements, but they'd miss a lot, as much on the other side of the lattice was blurry. Why had Hawkins climbed up here when he could just as easily have left the royal box on the second floor the way he came? As she shoved his body, sitting up behind the red curtain, it dawned on her. The wives were in seclusion. That meant they would enter the opera house separately, and a separate entrance was, from another point of view, a separate exit. Hawkins had been trying to leave the opera house without being seen. She tucked the curtain around his legs. That would have to do, and heaven help her if one of the royal wives found a corpse during the performance, and opened the edge of the lattice again. She peered out. The auditorium was still empty, but she could hear the murmur of many voices approaching. From behind the stage, she could hear other voices rising in scales and a violin being tuned. She dropped, hung on the railing and swung into the royal box on the level below. Everything seemed normal. It was empty. Just in case, she looked under the Khedive's red upholstered chair. There was a small rack for umbrellas and canes that ran under the chairs, and lying on that rack was Hawkins' silver cane. Why had he left it? An oversight? Had he been in a rush? She picked it up. An ordinary-looking metal cane, thick, with a straight silver handle coming off at an angle. It was heavy, but that was what he got for not using wood or bamboo like everyone else. An odd thing caught her eye. A section of about a handspan below the handle seemed to open up. It was held closed by two screws. She unscrewed them, opened the section. A bit of clockwork, like the back of a pocket watch. Wires. A smaller metal tube inside the top. No, not a tube. The muzzle of a small gun? She didn't understand how a cane could be a bomb, but what else could it be? Whatever it was, Hawkins had wanted to get away from it in a hurry. Pierrette went to the railing, cane still in hand, prepared to run through the auditorium to warn someone, but there was a crush of people at the door and a rush of sound as their conversations filled the giant space. She looked up at the levels of boxes. People were filling them too. Breathe. The Khedive would be the last to take his seat, with the Empress. Hawkins would have known that and set the timer to allow himself to escape. How long would it take to evacuate 800 people, even once she could make herself understood? What sort of panic would it cause? Would there be injuries in the rush to get out? No. There was only one thing to be done. Find the exit Hawkins had meant to use and get the cane out. Now! She hooked the cane onto the sash of her dress, gingerly, and climbed up again to the women's box. Then, with the cane in one hand, she opened the door and ran down a narrow corridor to a stairway, and nearly into the retinue of fine women in airy veils and beautiful jewellery, their servants yelling at Pierrette. Luckily, she was not well known at the palace, so if all went well and everybody lived, it was unlikely anyone would connect her name with the rude woman in the blue dress and raise questions about what Pierrette Arnaud had been up to. And if they did, so be it. She didn't have time to be discreet. She could only push her way through, apologising, hoping no one looked behind the curtain, if they made it that far. Then she rushed through the little crowd of women and out a small door into the street. It was full of vendors and people walking and taking the air, hoping for a glimpse of royalty. Pierrette ran through Opera Square, into the garden, the cane bouncing against her dress. A few silhouettes here or there, but away from the gaslight, the park was empty and dark. She slowed her pace and made for the slight curve she could just make out ahead, a footbridge over a pond. As she threw the cane and it splashed into the water, Pierrette stood for a second at the top of the bridge and felt like a child playing a game, placing bets on when the stick would float to the other side. But it sank immediately. She walked away as quickly as her lungs would let her, over to the garden wall. Minutes passed. She caught her breath. Distant music swirled in the opera house. The Empress must have arrived, and the performance had begun. Maybe it was all for nothing. What other explanation could there be for a cane with clockwork and wires inside? Perhaps many explanations. It could be any sort of device. She regretted not making Albert Hawkins talk before he died. She walked over to the loose stone in the wall and retrieved her cloak. Time to tell Gamal and Safia that the job was done, and to ask for their help in removing the body after the performance. Pierrette took one step toward the old city when, behind her, with a great rumble, bang, and a spray of water, the bomb went off. Chapter 3. In Gamal and Safia's house, Pierrette occupied the uppermost room, on its own floor, which caught the breeze. Her married friends took the middle floor. The bottom floor was divided into two sitting rooms and a kitchen. Pierrette loved the smaller sitting room best. The walls were decorated with framed aphorisms in beautiful Arabic calligraphy, and the shelves held Gamal's personal book collection, which never seemed to shrink despite his skill at selling them. It was unusual for a married couple to eat or talk together with a female guest in Cairo, but assassins were unconventional people. Besides, Safia said, Pierrette was practically family. It was also a house without servants. Gamal and Safia would not endanger them. So, the morning after the assassination, there was no one to disturb. They sat on cushions around a low table, and Gamal examined Pierrette's drawing of Hawkins's cane. He pointed to the arrangement of gears she'd sketched.
I'm surprised that clockwork had the strength to pull the wire, but it must have. I think you're right that there was a small pistol with a hair trigger in the cane's handle. It pointed toward a blasting cap, and the clockwork would create a delay so Hawkins could get to safety.
Pierrette rubbed her temple. None of them had got any sleep. After an inconvenient early hours trip back to the opera house to dispose of Hawkins's body. Luckily, none of the wives had shifted the curtain during the performance. Pierrette grimaced. How gruesome to think of it sitting there hidden behind the curtain while the wives listened to that sublime music. And the assassins had just barely got into the box before the cleaners, requiring a diversion and an arduous journey carrying the body through the corridors while avoiding said workers. So this morning her head was foggy.
I've seen drawings of the device that Confederate soldier used a few years ago, what they called the horological torpedo, Safia said. It used a clockwork mechanism, but that was so much bigger. 12 pounds of gunpowder. I don't see how one could fit that much gunpowder into a cane. Because it wasn't gunpowder, Gamal said grimly. It was dynamite.
Safia and Pierrette winced. They'd heard about the new explosive, made from nitroglycerin soaked into wood pulp or some other absorbent material, but they hadn't come across it yet.
A single stick of dynamite might not create sufficient damage on its own, Gamal explained. But maybe there was more than one stick, and gunpowder or something else added. Besides, the metal cane's containing effect would have amplified the blast, meaning one wouldn't need much explosive material.
It's ingenious, really. Of course, we'll never know whether the bomb would have achieved its purpose.
He looked almost wistful. The assassins didn't use bombs often, because of the likelihood of injuring innocent people. But they studied their enemies. Safia said,
Right under the Khedive's chair like that, I don't think it could have failed. And think of the shrapnel. Pierrette, you saved more than one life last night, I'm sure of it.
Pierrette reflected on what might have been. It made no sense for the Templars to kill Empress Eugenie after working here and in Paris to influence her. Perhaps that influence had failed, or perhaps the plan had been to call the Empress away at the last minute with an urgent telegram or something of the kind, saving her by apparent luck from yet another bombing. The first bombing the Empress had escaped seemed to make her and her husband even more authoritarian, so Pierrette suspected that was the explanation. The Templars liked what they thought of as strong governments, so long as those governments could be controlled by Templars, and they always could. It was all part of the Templar ambition to create their utopia, in which no individual's plans could interfere. The Khedive, though, was an obvious target. He bristled against Ottoman control and stood up to European empires. The Templars would not take this defeat as final. She pulled her shawl tighter.
We should send word to the Khedive security forces, warn them to be vigilant. The Templars won't stop here.
Gamal twisted the signet ring, a habit he had when he was thinking.
We thought the man who followed you that night had learned of your plan to kill Hawkins. But now I wonder whether they were simply monitoring us to make sure we stayed out of Hawkins's way. Maybe other assassins in Cairo had followers last night. We'd better go see Amira.
On their way to Amira's newspaper office, Pierrette thought about the first time she had saved Empress Eugenie from a bomb. That time, like this one, the Empress had no idea that she had a woman named Pierrette to thank. The first time, Pierrette had diverted one of the bombs destined for the Empress and her husband, Napoleon III, outside another opera house in Paris. She hadn't done it out of any feeling of duty to the royal pair, but to protect others and to fulfill a promise to a friend. That night, she hadn't been the only person trying to prevent bloodshed. Simeon Price, the first assassin she'd met, was there too. After that night, Simeon took Pierrette on as a student. For the next 4 years, they'd chased Simeon's own teacher and assassin traitor Oscar Kane until they finally cornered him in Bath and put an end to his efforts to obtain a terrible weapon. With Kane dead, Simeon had been eager to leave London. He'd become a minor celebrity there after his court-martial, and Simeon did not enjoy celebrity. Pierrette stayed. She had friends there, the Aurora troupe of circus performers. More than friends, her chosen family. So Simeon had gone his way and Pierrette had gone hers. However, Simeon's letters always arrived from a different place. The last one had been from a village in the south of Russia. He seemed happy enough, but it was always hard to tell with Simeon. And Pierrette, newly inducted into the British Assassins, had plenty to keep her busy at first. She was thrilled to find that as she gained skills and experience, the Council of Assassins would provide her with weapons, armour, and respect. She was sent to assassinate targets, and there were plenty of them. While she and Simeon had been focused on stopping Kane, they hadn't realised how quickly the Templars were spinning their webs throughout London's financial and commercial corridors. Over the next 5 years, Pierrette watched with frustration as the British assassins lost more ground. The council became more cautious with every setback. Ethan Fry, one of the most respected British assassins, was a wise man and an excellent teacher. but he seemed to be as distracted by other problems as she and Simeon had once been. His teenage children were younger than Pierrette, and though she trained and chatted with his daughter Evie sometimes, she felt lonely. She started seeking missions farther afield so that she'd be able to do as she liked. One day she'd gone to see the assassin George Westhouse in Crawley, frustrated that it had been months since she'd had anything to do. "The struggle is long," George had said with a kind smile. He was a dozen years older than Pierrette and came from a background similar to Simeon's. Simeon had started life working in a pub and George in a mill, both on the outskirts of London. They were both practical and private men. Maybe that's why she'd gone to him, hoping that he'd be a replacement for her old friend. But that smile had snapped something in her spirit.
"The struggle is long, but does it have to be eternal? I want to win. When do we win, George?"
The smile faded.
"You spent a decade of your life fighting an enemy who turned out to be an assassin who lost his way. Even if we destroyed the Templar organization, don't you think there will always be those who seek control of humanity, whether or not they call themselves Templars?"
"Yes, of course, but that doesn't mean we let them gather their strength. We can change this world. I know we can. It just takes courage."
He'd pursed his lips.
"Courage is not something the Brotherhood lacks."
She'd protested that wasn't what she meant, but he'd only held up his hand. He'd said,
"You came to the Brotherhood in an unorthodox way, Pierrette, and with an unorthodox teacher. Simeon was barely an assassin himself when he taught you, and his own grounding in the history and philosophy of the Brotherhood came from a tainted source. Perhaps we haven't done right by you. This isn't a game to be won or lost, Pierrette, and it's not a performance."
Her face had flushed. How dare he sneer at her background when her circus friends had risked their lives for the assassin cause? She and George had agreed it might be best for Pierrette to leave England for a while. George suggested she go to Egypt to learn about the roots of the Brotherhood, its artifacts and ancient secrets, to learn the history of the long struggle. Pierrette had been happy to get away, and to her delight, she'd found that the Egyptian assassins were powerful and not reluctant to target high-ranking Templars, and Moira was there. She had taught Simeon and had been a friend to Pierrette. Then a miracle happened. In the 2 years that Pierrette had been away from England, something had shifted. Ethan Fry's two children had gone off to London on their own and broken the Templars' hold without instructions or permission. She still couldn't quite believe it. Maybe the tide was turning. Maybe the assassins were ready to do whatever was necessary to take down the Templars despite the risks. She favoured bold action as she had seen the cost of hesitation too many times. Whether on the back of a horse or in a street fight, one always had to commit fully or fall. While the assassins grew braver in England, in Egypt they were already bold. Still, even in Cairo they kept to the shadows. At 60, or close to it, Amira Benyamina still wore the wide trousers and tailored waistcoat she had favoured when Pierrette first met her in Paris, and her silver curls did their best to escape a thick braid coiled around her head. She took the three assassins into her office at Le Soleil de l'Égypte, the French-language newspaper she ran, and shut the door. Pierrette handed her the blood-stained handkerchief bearing Hawkins's initials.
"I hear the city owes you a debt," Amira said, "not to mention Empress Eugenie, for the second time." Pierrette smiled.
"I was just remembering that, but I wonder whether she was really in any danger. The Templars seemed to see her as an asset and an ally. Maybe they meant to rescue her, scare her, while conveniently taking out the Khedive."
"And countless others," Amira said.
Gamal filled her in on the bomb design, and they learned that there had indeed been Templar tales following several Cairo assassins last night, all of them assassins who might well have tried to get a ticket to the opera performance for one reason or another.
"I wonder if we misjudged Albert Hawkins from the start," Amira mused. "He seemed a typical mountebank. I never dreamed he had the courage to carry out a bombing under the noses of palace security, or the sang-froid to murder scores of people. A terrible crime, even by Templar standards. I know they tell themselves that any cost is worth it so long as it furthers their aims, but even so, some Templars would hesitate to bomb an opera house full of people. I'll try to get more information on Albert Hawkins. It seems he was more powerful in the Order than we knew, unless he went rogue."
Safia nodded.
"I've been thinking about his railroad to nowhere." "A project for bilking speculators," Gamal said.
"But what if it served another purpose?" his wife responded. "I can understand why the Khedive would have said yes to one more railway, even one that ends in an empty spot, because the Khedive is convinced that the canal will soon be lined with new cities. But why would Hawkins have chosen that spot in particular? If he was only interested in making the Khedive allow forced labor, he would have wanted a contract to some place essential, like Helwan or Fayum. So why was he striking out for empty desert?"
Amira pondered the question. "Maybe it isn't so empty. I agree, it's worth investigating. I can tie up the loose ends here in the city. Are the three of you willing to go out and have a look at the spot his railroad was heading?"
"When should we go?" Pierrette asked, feeling tendrils of excitement.
"Tonight, if you can," Amira said. "Rest first, and travel by darkness. I'll have some camels ready with everything you'll need."
Action, with no arguments, no delays. Pierrette sighed happily. "You have no idea how refreshing it is to be in Egypt."
Chapter 4 They left the city in the evening, walking through the parts of Cairo without street lighting. The three of them looked similar and nondescript, in hooded coats over trousers, high boots, scarves over their mouths and noses, and daggers at their waists. Gamal, who had an unerring sense of direction even in the dark, leading them northeast. For more than an hour they walked in the sort of silence that can only be shared by three assassins on a journey. Soon the great obelisk of Heliopolis loomed ahead of them in the darkness, and there was the man Amira had arranged to meet them. He had three camels, laden with packs of food and water. Pierrette had only ridden a camel twice. She found it tiring as her body was so used to horses that sitting differently on a creature with different responses was a constant drain on her thoughts. The evening turned pleasantly cool, a perfect early November night. They continued northeast into open desert, avoiding the roads. On previous camel rides in the desert, Pierrette had been astonished at the view from the high seat, the sense of moving through the wideness of the world. But it was so dark that she could only see a few feet around them, the animals stepping around tumbled stones. The silence was broken only by the occasional low rumble from a camel, or an update from Gamal on where they were. Shortly after dawn, they came across a railway track. It ran northwest to southeast, from Alexandria toward the canal, and this was its nearest point to Cairo.
"This is Hawkins's railroad," Gamal said. "We follow it southeast, but first, breakfast."
He checked his pocket watch, and Safia and Pierrette shared a little smile. Gamal was an excellent orienteer. He said it came from years poring over old books of maps, and he liked to play a game in which he'd make some ridiculously precise estimation and then prove it right. He'd once argued that cutting through a particular alley would be a faster route from one city gate to another, and raced the fastest runner among the Cairo assassins to prove it. He'd never lay a wager, but enjoyed the looks on his colleagues' faces when he managed some feat. Pierrette's smile widened as she asked, "How long will it take us, Camel?"
"About 15 hours."
"About?" Safia teased. "What is this about?"
"Fine,"
he grinned.
15 and a quarter hours.
As the day warmed, they continued to follow the tracks straight through the open desert. The land rose in hills or drifts, so they guided the camels down the tracks. As Safia pointed out, it was not as though a train was running on Hawkins's line to nowhere. They kept a brisk pace. All the same, the long day was punctuated only by breaks to eat, drink, pray, or, in Pierrette's case, keep watch and let the camels rest. Shortly after sunset, the railway track ended abruptly, running into the sand, or so it appeared by the way the drifts covered its final steel inches. They dismounted, and Pierrette swung a small lantern around the area, illuminating signs that people had been working here not long before. A broken one-wheeled cart, a few twisted pieces of metal, and a camel skeleton. It had a ghostly feeling, this work interrupted, as though some disaster had intervened. But it had only been Hawkins's greed. When the Khedive had ordered a stop to his use of forced labour, Hawkins had paused the project. They rested before the final push, onto the track's proposed terminus. Gamal said they were not far from the canal now. Gamal had not forced them to end their breaks on any specific schedule, and Pierrette wondered whether his predictions would hold. When at last he halted and said,
"This is the place,"
she knew he'd got it right. He would have said something if he'd been wrong.
"And was it 15 and one quarter hours? Safia asked.
15 hours, 14 minutes, he said. "Let me check the elevation of that hill, but I'm sure this is the spot."
There was nothing to mark it, and there were certainly no signs of Templars anywhere. They'd timed their arrival for nighttime on purpose, so that they could approach any enemies under cover of darkness. They stood motionless and listened, but heard nothing. They walked a wide circle, but saw nothing.
"A false path," Pierrette said at last. Her voice sounded small and strange in all that nothingness.
"Maybe, and maybe not," Safia said. "We'll see what the morning shows us. The camels need a proper rest anyway."
The camels were already kneeling. The three assassins piled the packs on the ground. Gamal and Pierrette sat with their backs against them. Safia paced, taking first watch. She was often on watch, because her eyesight and her powers of observation were among the best of the Cairo assassins, and she could sense an enemy in a crowd before Gamal or Pierrette had even become suspicious. So it fell to Safia to stay awake while Pierrette tried to sleep. Pierrette had never liked darkness. Simeon had set her all sorts of challenges to get her used to it, but she hated them all.
"I am not a lurker by nature," she'd said to him one day.
He'd laughed. "And I am, I admit it. But it's something you must learn to tolerate, Pierrette."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.